Okay, it's kind of sort of business related. Notebooks. Notebooks. There have been three physical things that I've always just kind of been enamored with. One is a great notebook. Two are great pens. And when I say a great pen, I don't mean a Mont Blanc. I don't mean high end. I mean pens that write really well. And watches. Wristwatches. I mean, nobody wears them much anymore because we have cell phones. Notebooks. Notebooks, here's where notebooks really play a role, because if you're not capturing ideas and if you're not capturing thoughts, and there's tons of ways to do that in the digital world. Evernote is terrific. I love it. I've been using it. I have a hard time not remembering not using it, but I love Evernote. And there's all kinds of online cool things. Now, being a guy who's fond of the spoken word, I'm big on voice memos. Doesn't matter whatever app you use on your phone. I've got some that I'm kind of partial to, but it doesn't matter. Just so I can hit record and speak into it. Like if I'm at the gym, if I'm on a treadmill, if I'm doing something and I really don't want to take the time to get out a pad and pen, but really fond of notebooks, really fond of doodling, really fond of just jotting down snippets of things. So let's go through these. I've mentioned some of these in the past, but the oldest kind of notebook that I've used with tremendous regularity since high school. So it's a long time. High school was a long, long time ago for me. Is called a reporter's notebook. Reporter's notebook. And here's what they look like. They are terrific because of their size. Now, I'm picky about these. This particular notebook is made by Ampad, A-M-P-A-D. It is, oddly enough, it is a Richardson, Texas-based company. That is a northern suburb of Dallas, Texas. So that is kind of cool. I can support the hometown crowd. These are Greg ruled. You may not know what that means. Greg ruled. A lot of shorthand kind of. Well, here, let me show you. Greg ruled. They are, yes, they're ruled like notebook paper, but they're spaced further apart. Wider, kind of wider or taller ruling. This particular notebook, and these are not expensive, by the way. These are a couple of bucks a piece, 70 pages. I like this brand, and I'm partial to it for a couple of reasons. They hold up. The pages are easy. These things ever drive you crazy? Because they do me. I mean, there's some notebooks, and they just don't. You just can't. You're just wrestling to, okay, Ampad does a good job. I don't pretend to know the precision of the twisting of this wire, but I like it. The thing I really like, aside from the quality of the paper, which that matters too, is this. Thickness of the cover, not only the front, but also the back. So when you flip this thing to an open page, now you've got two, you've got the front and the back, and it's a really nice platform upon which to write. I buy these I buy them online, because you're not going to find these. You're probably not going to find these in a store, but you can buy them at any office supply company. You can go to their web store, their online store, and buy them. I buy them in packs of 12 because they're only a couple of bucks a piece. So this is the old standby favorite, and easy to carry. The size of this is 4x8. 4x8. So I would put that number one as far as economical. Easy to carry, easy to write in, easy to work, and cheap. The other one that most everybody, and this is one of the few that I have that's hasn't been used yet and is still in the seal, which is why I'm using it, is the, let me get it where it doesn't reflect, is the old moleskin. Now, I like this size. I have a variety of sizes. In fact, moleskin makes a reporter's version, but it's about twice as wide as this. I hate it. I hate it. Here, I've got one. I'll show it to you. This is the moleskin version of the reporter's notebook. I just don't like it. And I'll show you why I don't like it. Now, here it is. So here's the regular reporter's notebook. So it's that much wider. That's one thing I don't like about it. Now, they call this the reporter's, I think. So, and it flips the same way. Okay, well, that doesn't work in a moleskin. Not for me, because you can't fold it back up over itself. So now you're going to write on this page. And now how are you going to write on that page? You're either going to have to flip the thing over or just write upside down. Well, you're not really writing upside down, but you're starting on the bottom of the page. Anyway, I hate this. Bad idea. Dropped all kind of stuff on the floor. So that's one that I just absolutely do not recommend. I like this size. It works for me. These are more expensive. These are, what are these? $5 or $6 a piece. So they're stupid price. 192 pages, 3.5 by 5.5. Good size, and I do use them. I buy these in bulk as well, and yes, I buy them online. Some years ago, a company, I think in Chicago, aren't they from Chicago? And I fell in love with these little books, Field Notes. I like these. And one of the things that I like, they're just kind of retro, which I found kind of cool. 48 pages. They're very durable. And I like the fact that the paper is graph kind of paper. I think that's cool. Some people don't. I think you can buy these maybe you can't buy these as ruled. Maybe they're all this way. They got some cool stuff on the inside, you know, where you can put that it belongs to you, and they print their story and stuff on the back. So some just cool. These are sold in 3-packs, and can't remember. They're not cheap, but they're not crazy expensive. Least expensive, this is probably next. That moleskin, the little bitty one, not real cheap. I had a meeting a long time ago. I sat down and was having a conversation with a friend of mine, James Dahlman. James lives up in Oklahoma City, and we were sitting down, and he whipped out one of these, and I'm like, what is that notebook? Okay, it's a moleskin. I hadn't seen this. This was a couple of years ago. So I went and bought some. In fact, I bought 3 of them. The paper is kind of that vanilla color. It's ruled. This is kind of a cardboard thing, and I don't know if the webcam will show this, but that's kind of a stitched. It's not kind of. It is a stitched binding. It's moleskin, and it's very cool. I can't tell you. It has a kind of a neat. It has a little pocket thing in the back, which is kind of cool. But I'm pretty fond of this. They're moleskin, so they're not inexpensive. And in fact, these are called moleskin. I don't know. You pronounce that. Can you read that? Here, let me get it where I can focus. There it is. And, 3 packs. Seems like a 3-pack was, Could it be 20 bucks, something like that? Now, a month or two ago, I can't remember who put me onto this, but I kind of like these. And let me tell you what I like about them. I like the size. And you would think from the color scheme, moleskin. No, they just kind of, I don't know who had it first. Here's what I like about it. Now, let me tell you, it's from a company called White Lines. I bought these at Amazon. These are not, they're not terribly cheap. They're not crazy ridiculous, but I like the fact that it has a wire binding. Really fond of that for obvious reasons. It is A4 lined. And unlike most lines that are done in darker color, the lines on this one are done in white. The paper itself is kind of a grayish color, but the lines are white. And you'll notice the paper has a perf. It's perforated. So if you want to tear the page out, you can do that, and it's a clean tear, and it's not all of these, you know, things ripped out. Kind of cool. It is, and they're sizable. So, you know, it's, they do millimeters. Like, I know what that is. Swedish, by the way. 210 by 297 millimeters, 70 pages. So good size, you know, a good size notebook to give you some comparison. Here's the moleskin. So pretty good size for comparison. Here's the reporters. See if my hands are big enough. And then the little bitty one. I left one out. The field notes. Field notes. It's here somewhere. I dropped it on the floor. Field notes is even smaller. So that's five different sizes of notebooks. Now, you may not be a notebook freak. You may just grab any old spiral notebook. I can't do that. I can't. It sounds snobbish. I know it sounds snobbish. I can't go get just some little spiral notebook at Walmart, just some little cheap thing. I can't do it. Now, let me tell you another favorite. This is the big boy. And I can go to Walmart and get these, I think. No, you know, I have to go to a office supply store. You know, Staples and Office Max, Office Depot. And these are drawing. These are sketchbooks. Again, I'm fond of the spiral. These, the front and the back, this is plastic. It's not cardboard. It's plastic. These have no ruling at all. They're just clean white paper. Can't tell you how many pages, but pretty thick. These are $7. $7-$8, something like that. But I use the snot out of these. I really like these. Other than reporter and field notes, I use these probably more than anything. Now, to give you some scope and scale, this is that one. So this sketchbook is just a little bit bigger than the White Lines notebook. So I've got all the sizes represented. I got pretty much, you know, a variety of price points represented here. And I'm into notebooks. What can I tell you? Now, there's the big problem, and that is, well, okay, once you fill them, then what do you do with them? I'd love to tell you that I have mine just in chronological order, and they're just nicely placed somewhere on a shelf. They're not. I'll just put one away and dig another one out. I'd love to tell you that I go back and I look through them with great regularity. I don't. I have a stack over here off camera that you can't see. I have a stack of two of these that are full, and I have a handful of field notes that are full that I'm staring at, and I've got a couple of the moleskins. Now, the reporter notebooks, man, they're everywhere. I got them everywhere because I've been using that one for the longest. So I'll keep the last two or three kind of within spitting distance. I don't necessarily go back and look at them with great regularity, but once in a while I do. And then I'll fill another one and I'm like, okay, I need to put those away. I probably should burn them because who knows what I've written in them. Snarky things. Maybe some terrible things about some people, I don't know. Maybe some true confessions. I just, I don't exercise tremendous restraint when I'm jotting down things and ideas. So those are my notebooks of choice. I don't know what your habit is, but if you are not in a habit of putting things down on paper, I find something very not only cathartic, but just, I don't know, there's just some energy there. There's just some energy in getting it down on paper. There's some energy for me in drawing some things, and even if it's just circles and arrows and boxes and just getting some ideas down. I don't organize in these, so it's not like, okay, I'm going to date today. No, you don't often find dates in mine. You might, but you probably don't. It's just kind of the stream of consciousness thing. So there are ways that I think you could probably capture these things in a more organized fashion. I don't. Anyway, that's kind of how I roll. Now, there are some online tools and I love to capture things in voice memos, for instance, when a pen and paper are not handy. I love Evernote, but I still like pen and paper. And sometimes, I mean, here, I'm the freakoid that has two mechanical pencils handy. Oh, and you remember the old gum erasers? Bet you hadn't seen one of those in a while. I at least use the gum, art gum erasers, as opposed to those big pink bar of soap looking things. Yeah, because they leave pink tint on the paper and tear the paper up. So if you're going to erase, use the gum eraser. So I've got two mechanical pencils and a gum eraser. I mean, does anybody use those? I do. So how do you capture your ideas? Do you capture your ideas? Do you have ideas? Sure. We all have ideas. I'm going to leave you with, because this is an idea. And I read about this young lady. Well, I'm thinking it was 2009. There's a young lady in Dallas, Maddie Bradshaw, M-A-D-D-I-E, I believe. Anyway, last night was Shark Tank, and I didn't realize she'd ever been on Shark Tank. 15 years old when she was on Shark Tank. I think she's 16 now. Anyway, starts the company when she's like 10 or something. She wanted to have magnetic something or other on her school locker, so an uncle had given her 50 bottle caps, you know, the old bottle caps. Anyway, she figured out a way to attach a magnet on the back of it, and she painted little stuff and inserted little things inside the bottle caps and stuck them on her locker. Goes to a local little store and says, you know, do you mind selling these? Well, they sold out, and next thing you know, the thing blows up. And by the time she goes on Shark Tank, and I already knew the story because I'm in Dallas. Anyway, Mark Cuban's on Shark Tank, and so she and her little sister and her mom go before the sharks, and they're asking for $300,000 and 15% of the company, because what they want to do is go global. And of course, it's really, most of the time the sharks go, well, have you got any sales? And they're expecting the answer to be no. And the mother pipes up and says, yeah, we've been in business for about 5 years now, and our sales over the course of that time have topped $5 million. And of course, they, Well, what were the sales last year? 1.6 million. I don't know when this was taped. Well, and what was the profit? A million. The most expensive price point, the most expensive price point that they have is $10. I think the website is snapcapsonline.com. It's a great story. It's a great story. Here's the tie-in. Do you have a bottle cap idea? I don't mean specifically a bottle cap, but let's use that as a metaphor. Do you have a bottle cap idea? Do you have bottle cap ideas? Do you just let them run through your head and enter one ear and go out the other? Or do you capture them? And better yet, upon capturing them, do you do anything with them? I don't mean go back and read them. I mean, do you act on them at all? Do you do anything with these ideas and with these doodles and with the stuff that you capture and you write down? You realize that most people don't. There is absolute truth to the whole 1% thing. I don't much care about the economy of it all. Oh, well, the 1%, and they need to be helping all of us, you know, who couldn't do it, didn't do it, wouldn't do it. No, I don't buy that. I don't buy that. There is truth to the 1%, and I don't mean with all of that political stuff. It very well could be that 1% of the people actually have ideas and do something with it. Did you ever think about that? And maybe 99% of us, oh, we have an idea. But unlike Maddie Bradshaw, we don't do anything with our ideas. Well, I'm exhorting you in this video, capture your ideas, write them down, catalog them, brainstorm, get it out of your head on paper, ponder it, roll it over in your mind, think about it, and then go act on it. Do something with it. My name is Randy Cantrell. The website is Bula, B-U-L-A, network.com. And this is the Yellow Studio.